We will move to our last speaker from Malaysia, Dr. Ramli Musa. He is the Associate Professor and Consultant Psychiatrist in the Department of Psychiatry in Kuliah of Medicine, International Islamic University of Malaysia. He will talk about the influence of depression and anxiety and stress on the quality of life of dialysis patients.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. InshaAllah for the next 15 minutes, I'm going to talk about the psychiatric mobility among the dialysis patient and also actually about their quality of life. You know, when we talk about renal failure patients, there will be interesting to look at the prevalence of psychiatric morbidities among this group of patients. I think without looking at the previous studies, you probably at the back of your mind think that the prevalence is quite high. But then, based on the, it is actually true enough that based on our literature search that there are actually a handful studies done to look at this prevalence of psychiatric disorder among this group. However, you have to be careful in terms of to interpret this figure because sometimes these studies are rather actually small in sample size, and there will be also actually issue in terms of the selection of the patients or the subjects. I think it is going to be more interesting if, let's say, we can look at the quality of life and try to look at this quality of life. Is there any association with the psychiatric comorbidities? And finally, we need to decide which tool will be good to be used in this group of patients in our objective to achieve to measure the psychiatric comorbidities and as well as quality of life. And in fact, actually, to tell you the truth, this is these are actually the objective of this the study that I'm going to present to you. Now, when we talk about psychiatric morbidities, these are the possible psychiatric morbidities that have been reported based on the previous studies. Top in the list is depression. In fact, actually, many studies, they basically look at the aspect of depression only, not the other aspect of psychiatric morbidities, for example, like anxiety disorder. I just quote one not so new studies by Chen et al. It has been reported that about 33% of these patients are suffering from depression. However, this study is a rather small sample size. The other psychiatric morbidities may happen is like suicidal behavior, and why actually these patients may have this suicidal behavior is a but closely related to depression and also related to delirium as well. And delirium is quite common among these patients. The causes of delirium among these patients are mainly like hyperuremia, anemia, hyperparathyroidism, and one syndrome called dialysis disequilibrium syndrome. Usually, these syndromes patients would develop delirium right after they had the dialysis. This is mainly because of the electrolyte balance caused by the hemodialysis or peritoneal dialysis. Last but not least, is a patient may also suffer from anxiety and as well as panic symptoms. You know, when you talk about another cause of delirium is actually is the medication itself. And you know that this group of patients, they are quite vulnerable, they are having many other medical comorbidities. For example, hypertension and diabetic. And even the medical medications itself may cause a patient to manifest a psychiatric presentation. For example, I just probably mentioned the common ones that we actually prescribe to the patient. For example, like aspirin may cause anxiety, insomnia, confusion, and psychosis. Interferon may also actually cause confusion, psychosis, depression, and so on. And also prednisolone is actually quite well known to cause psychosis, depressive-like syndromes, and also anxiety. Now, you probably would like to know why this patient vulnerable to develop psychiatric morbidity. Mainly, I can postulate that there are various reasons. Number one is because of the nature of the illness itself. We know that chronic renal failure patient, the illness is called as chronic, permanent, and it can be quite troublesome in the sense that a lot of time need to be consumed for them to go for dialysis. For example, to talk about mainly in our settings, usually, the patient most commonly will be go for the hemodialysis. So basically, they have to go through the dialysis process three times a week, and every session will take around 4 to 5 hours. And the other group of patients is we call it CAPD, which stands for continuous ambulatory peritoneal dialysis, where this patient can perform the dialysis at home. You know, it's also actually related to the cost of dialysis, which is quite hefty. It is not only about the cost of dialysis, but if you look at the surgical procedure, for example, the AV fistula that they have to create in order for them to perform the hemodialysis, is quite costly too. I mean, in Malaysia, for that procedure will cost around 5 to 6 thousand. And if, let's say, the procedure is successful, then patient have to go once. But if, let's say, the AV fistula failed, then have to go for another procedure, and that will incur another cost. And of course, we know that they have other medical conditions as well. Now, in treatment of depression among for this group of patients, we got to be careful because some selection of antidepressant may not be suitable. Generally, I just would like to highlight here, for example, like venlafaxine is not really a good choice. Because you know that one of the common side effects of venlafaxine is may increase the blood pressure. And we know that chronic renal patient, most of them why they're actually having a chronic renal patient, mainly because of one of the main common reason is hypertension. So you've got to be careful if, let's say, you decided to select this group of antidepressants. Generally, I would actually prefer to use SSRI, definitely, for example, like citalopram or sertraline. Because generally, SSRI are quite safe in terms of their side effect profiles. And if, let's say, you look at the dose, basically, the practice is the same principle that we are using to prescribe among elderly. You start low, go slow. So generally, this group of patients will require between half to two or two-thirds of normal therapeutic dose. Now, let me show you the study that we have done recently. And this study actually was funded by Ministry of Science, Technology and Information Malaysia. Basically, in this study, we're actually using two tools. Number one is DAS21, which is stand for Depression, Anxiety and Stress Scale. Number two, to measure the quality of life, we're using WHO BRAC, which consists of 26 items. We are blessed that these two tools, we have Malay and as well as Chinese version. Both are validated. As you know, that Malaysia is a multiracial country, mainly the race distribution, mainly Malays is about 70%, Chinese about 20%. So this using of this version is quite important to cover a large group of patients. We did a stratified random sampling. Why stratified? Because in this study, we tried to look at different settings. One is a private hospital, the other one is a government hospital, as well as NGOs. We think that this we need to cater this different group of patients because their backgrounds are different. Many of us can say that the private hospital, they have a better financial status, they have better resources. Now, we are quite lucky that in Malaysia we have quite complete updated national rental registry, where we have very complete data and the list of patients. Based on this registry, it has been listed that about 25,700 patients are on dialysis. And from this, the selection of sample is basically based on this figure. And from the 25,000, this figure was actually selected to be included in this study. However, when you look at the inclusion criteria and so on, so finally we got this figure, 1,383 patients. So our analysis will be basically based on our final figure. This study involved a total of 23 hospitals, including government and NGOs. You know, for the third objective, we try to look at the validity of the questionnaire. We are actually using the highest standard of validations approach, that is a confirmatory beta analysis, by using, if you are familiar with this, the latest statistical analysis, that is what we call a structured question model, SEM. Now, this is the result. Okay, this is the prevalence. We can see that one fourth of the patients, they are actually suffering from depression and stress. And if you look at anxiety, about half of them actually suffer from anxiety. Now, this analysis is actually based on DAS. We include the category of mild, moderate, severe, and extremely severe. Now, when we look at the quality of life, actually the analysis is quite lengthy, but I just show you just highlight to you a few areas that look interesting to us. Now we look at the correlation between the psychiatric mobilities and quality of life. There is a correlation, but then it is only actually focusing on the aspect of depressions as well, mainly. Of course, there are certain figures, stress also is considered as significant. Now, based on our structured equation model, we actually draw a theoretical pathway in order to understand the whole concept of psychological distress and as well as quality of life of this patient. As what you can see here, this task actually consists of depression, which contributes to the total score, anxiety, and as well as stress. The quality of life, as you know, that they are basically three main domains which contribute to the total number of quality of life score. And we will draw a line here to see what is the relationship between these two. Now we look at quite busy after the result came out. So as what you can see here, generally when we talk about if the figure is 0.9, it's a very good figure. So as what you can see here, depression is, the psychological distress is mainly contributed about 90% by depression, anxiety, and almost 100% by stress. And the quality of life as well, the figure here is quite excellent. And if you look at this figure, so the figure is a negative 0.51, which means it's a modest in terms of the strength. And the correlation is rather reverse in nature. What does it mean? Which means that those actually having a high score of DAS would cause low total score of quality of life. So that is the interpretation of the figure. This is another analysis. We look at how actually this anxiety, depression, and stress, they are quite closely related based on this figure. So what are the conclusions that we can draw from this study? Number one, we know that the psychiatric mobilities are high among our patients. And I think one of the strengths of this study is actually it is done in a large number of subjects. So hardly actually you see any figure actually with a sample size of 1,000 and above. And mainly the quality of life is related to level of depression rather than other aspects of domains. And we finally concluded that DAS21 and WHO quality of life are suitable to be used for this profession. So with that, I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ramli, for this interesting topic. And I would like to thank all the speakers. I will open the discussion now. So please address your question or comments to the speakers. Mike, please.
Assalamu alaikum. Thanks for the nice presentation of the speakers. Actually, I want to direct my contribution and question to the topic on cyberbullying. And from what I see in the presentation, it's so good, so educative and informative. But what I observe is the intervention aspects. I don't know if it includes the psychotherapeutic part, because I can see that you are talking from the psychiatric angle through the use of antidepressants, pharmacological treatments or whatever. But from what you explained to us, these effects or the symptoms exhibited by these students are like psychologically related. They are more related to mood problems, depression, hopelessness, helplessness. These are core depressive symptoms that are very related to suicide. And of course, based on your findings, based on your reports, there are a lot of suicide cases, reported or not reported. So I don't know if there is any link between psychiatrists and clinical psychologists in terms of coming up with interventions. A lot of speakers have spoken in this conference. Basically, of course, most are psychiatric related treatments, methods. So I think there is need for a more collaborative approach to intervention when there is drug-related therapies and psychotherapeutic-related interventions coming together, because when we are talking of chronic depression, we are talking about suicide. I don't think, personally, based on my limited knowledge as a student, I don't think drug or all these antidepressants is enough. Of course, we don't need to be talking about the side effects, weight gain, and what have you. My doctor from Malaysia is just talking about or one of the side effects to be high blood pressure. I don't know if I can be taking a drug to solve the pressure, and at the same time I'm having a BP. I don't think I can take that drug. So the issue here is, if we can accept drug is not enough, what are the collaborative or more comprehensive or more integrative approach to intervention, linking the drug treatment and psychotherapeutic intervention, considering that bullying is a daily thing. The internet, the cell phone in particular, has worsened it among students, because students are now using cell phones. Primary school students, secondary school students, they send a lot of messages to themselves. Even in Malaysia, in Southeast Asia, this is very, very common. Talk more of a Western country like the US. So it's a daily thing. The intervention you've told us, or some of the treatment method, is somehow like avoidance approach. The students cannot cut themselves away from the internet, from their cell phone. They will continue going back to it. But the fact remains is, all these are like externally related. So maybe drugs might not be really enough to solve this suicide, to solve this depression. So I don't know if there's any collaborative or any integrative approach to intervention. Thank you.
Thank you for your very important question. Actually, in our inpatient unit, we are based on dialectic behavior therapy, which is kind of a form related to the CBT that you talked about. So when the depression and the suicidality is really severe, we have to deal with that by involving them in therapy. And even when we see them for medication management, we also have to provide some kind of supportive therapy. Validation is always really important, because these kids come from a situation that they feel very bad and they are not